You know, it happened again. I took a day off streaming, and what happens? This happens. Fantastic stuff. Wow. Estia, how do you put these out so quickly?
Mr. Biden, a quick word for the BBC.
The BBC, I'm Irish.
Come out, you black and tans. Come out and fight me like a man. Show your white value and medals down in Flanders. Show her how the IRA made you run like hell away from the green and lovely lanes of Killashandra.
Mr. Biden, a quick word for the BBC.
The BBC, I'm Irish.
He was so real for this. He was so goddamn real for this, man. Holy shit. God, he's so funny. I hope we continue in this legacy of funny presidents, by the way, because Joe Biden actually is very funny when he's given the chance. He's not as funny as Trump, not even close, but Trump is the funniest president we've ever had. And then Biden's up there. I don't know if he's as funny as LBJ would have been if LBJ had been around for modern social media, but, you know, still very funny. And I really hope our next president's funny, too. Lincoln was supposed to be pretty funny. Yeah, I think I've heard that. I could see that. Have you been sobbing all day because of the Queen's death? Well, the Queen isn't really dead. My mom is doing fine, actually. The Queen of England, however, is in hell right now. Love my mom. Oh, yeah, deep in hell. Obama was so funny during the correspondence dinner that Trump brought the country into fascism's vengeance. Okay, yeah, but Obama was always funny in a very planned way. You know what I mean? Like, Obama was very charismatic, and he would use his charisma to be funny, but always in, like, a very deliberate, strategic, you know, like, right up the script kind of way. He was not off-the-cuff funny in the way that Trump has always been, and the way Biden, whenever his, like, neurons misfire, whenever he has a little synapse collapse. Dark Trust Rising. Yeah. Meets Liz Truss once, dies instantly. Aw, man, dude. Imagine if Liz Truss was a real person and not just like a collection of business interests molded together into the shape of a human being.
I'm not against any of them personally. I'm against the idea that people can be born to rule. That people, because of the family they're born into, should be able to be the head of state of our country. I think that's disgraceful.
Well, this isn't the Liz Truss you guys are going to have as your Tory lead anymore, so, yeah, sorry. Sorry. Yeah. That Truss died a long time ago. She's undercover now. It's all a plan. That'd be good.
Pigeon?
How do you feel about the... Oh, well. She probably feels good about all this. People are mad. Of course people are mad. How could they not be? Obviously people are mad. But man, people are mad. Funny stuff though, huh? Stop rewatching the present, please? Yeah. This could be a bad sign. British kings named Charles tend to dissolve parliament and establish personal rule. I guess we'll see how it plays out.
Pigeon, what on earth are you doing?
She's zipping. That's what she's doing. She's zipping and she's zooping. Listen, I don't have like a ton to say on the... Listen, I'm going to be honest with you guys. I don't know that much about Queen Elizabeth II. May she burn in hell. I genuinely don't know that much. There are a couple of tidbits I'm aware of, but for the most part, my opposition to her is part of my broader opposition to the concept of the monarchy. I find the British monarchy, like, existentially disgusting. That's the thing. Like, the main issue that I have with it is that, like, people pretend she has no political power just because all of her institutional power is antiquated and wouldn't actually, like, work in real life, which may or may not be true. You have no idea how bad things can get, but... even if we assumed her institutional power was entirely vestigial, like, being a symbol doesn't mean you have no power. Like, why would you think a person has no political power just because all they are is, like, the representative of your country and the reigning symbol of the aristocracy? Like, why would you, like, obviously that's power. Of course that's power. The character of the monarch, of the British monarch, is going to have a pretty significant influence over national discourse and the attitude of the country. I mean, of course. You know, and it's like a sickness in the mind of the British people. I'm usually willing to give a lot more leeway to people who are in bad institutions than most lefties. Like, because it's about like historical materialism, right? Whether you like it or not, the current system demands the existence of landlords. That's true. without decommodified housing, you can't not have landlords, because otherwise there would be no way to move without buying the property you're moving into. That'd be like, you can't obviously, like, no, like, you, it's not doable. That you would need some institution to pay rent to. And as long as we have commodified housing, landlords need to exist. Police officers need to exist. As long as our system exists in the way that it does, it literally can't function without police officers. There are a lot of institutions for which that's the case. The bourgeoisie. Capitalism literally can't exist without the bourgeoisie. I mean, obviously, like, literally, like, that's in the name, right? Of course. But Britain can exist without a fucking monarchy. Britain is capitalist. There is nothing about material inevitability that demands the existence of a fucking monarchy. There is nothing about the systems they have in place that necessitate the existence of a fucking monarchy. They aren't some, it's not like it's some like impoverished third world country that doesn't necessarily have all the institutional force and civic, you know, civic society necessary to establish a democracy. Like, if it was like some super impoverished country and there was a monarch and like there wasn't really, like, you can make allowances, you can be understanding, you can recognize that, you know, the ideal isn't always possible. But England is a democracy. They're a democracy and they're capitalist. Why the fuck? It's not just that they have, like, liberals. Liberals want you to believe that, like, the English monarchy is just like they're a tourist destination. This is the CGP Grey approach, where they're just like cutesy tourist guys and, oh my God, what a whimsical castle. Like, ignoring the insane amount of money and land that the royal family owns, like, to begin with, and the insane power they have, not only in controlling the national attitude, but also in, like, the direct relationships they have with politicians. Leaving all of that aside, and Lord knows they have power. They have so much power. Like, the British people don't think of her as, like, a cutesy little tourist destination. There are plenty of interviews you can see on the street with Brits, okay? They treat her like a living god, because she might as well fucking be, according to their own system. The British democracy, institutionally, derives its power from the monarchy, and the monarchy is the head of the Church of England, chosen by God. If you buy into all of that, the Queen is literally the God-given ruler of your country. Like, it's literally like a divine monarchy, the godhead, you know, which is insane. Like, Bosh, barely anyone sees that way. No, don't you lib out on me. Most people won't recognize that that's what they think of it as, but the attitude is pervasive, which is why you can't fucking criticize the Queen that much if you want to succeed in British politics, okay? I know enough about the way this discourse gets handled over there to know that she does not get treated like some kind of quaint, cutesy tourist artifact to bring mirth and joy to people who visit England, okay? There is real power there, and there is a real national sentiment, sort of biased towards her legitimacy. And how many people, by the way, do you see who are British, who are constantly praising her grace and poise and elegance? Kind of a weird thing to praise somebody for, like, if you think about it in the modern world. In the modern world, generally speaking, when you praise, like, a powerful political figure, normally it's their efficacy, right? Their strength, their willingness to get stuff done. But in her case, it's how well she's willing to fit the role of the divinely appointed leader. You understand? Her ceremonial rule, like, don't pretend ceremony means nothing. Ceremony is what people have been living and dying for millennia, okay? Ceremony starts wars. The national character associated with her, at least in large part, I mean, is a sort of passive affirmation of those roots, the God Queen or whatever, which is disgusting, you know? In America, our democracy, you know, the formal legitimacy of our democracy is rooted in the will of the people, right? Like, that's the idea, like, governance of the sovereign. That's the idea. Like, that's what American democracy is rooted in. You know, symbols have power. And even this stuff, you know, it's this liberal attitude, like, well, if it's not codified, well, it doesn't have to be codified. Your fucking constitution isn't codified. This stuff has... It's important. So, of course, I'm not accusing you of wanting to keep the monarchy around, okay? I know not all Brits are like that, but a good number of them are. Okay, British people in chat, Who here, okay, please, I'm being serious here. Who here would agree that there are plenty of people in your country who are more than a bit fucking weird about the Queen? Like a little wacky. You guys get a little, like a little wacky, you know? It's not just like, oh, she's like a cute, like, you know, yeah, I've seen, okay? And I'm not gonna go digging through polling data on how many British people are willing to sign off on the idea that she should be like, you know, reinstated God Empress of mankind or whatever, you know, the Phoenix Rising, the emergent figure of renewed British neocolonialism. But I know that people get weird about this. Here's BBC News. Yeah, man, shit like this is fucking weird. Abolish the monarchy.
Concerns. You're watching this BBC News special on the concerns, significant health concerns, of a team of doctors who are taking care of the Queen at Balmoral. We just heard the latest there from an estate that is relatively secluded, certainly, compared to our next location where Damian Grammaticus is standing by at Buckingham Palace. Damian, the news a little bit earlier on today that the doctors in Scotland were concerned about the Queen's health coming as Liz Truss was making a rather important statement concerning the future of energy bills. That, of course, insignificant now, given the gravity of the situation we seem to be experiencing.
Well, certainly overshadowed, Clive, yes, by that announcement from the palace here.
But you're watching this BBC News special.
Oh, yeah, totally agree. As I understand it right now, in Britain, if you turn on a light bulb, usually like a house member will activate like an analog timer they've wound to like keep track of how long the light bulb's been on. You know, it's like, all right, we've got 30 seconds of electric light today, you know, make the best of it. And, like winding up the yeah, it's not good. Pigeon, Jesus, she's zooming. Yeah, energy prices over there are spiking because of inflation, war with Russia, the available, blah, 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 you know. We benefit a lot over here in the States because the States already has a fuck ton of oil, you know, in our territory. And we also aren't as connected to, like, the broader, pan-Eurasian grid because, of course, we're on a separate continent. The UK has had 3 PMs in 4 years. Brexit withdrawal, cost of living crisis. The Queen's dead. They're fucked. Well, they should just get rid of the monarch. I know it'll never happen. Like, I know it's not going to happen. You know, you can dream about it, but it's not going to happen. UK energy price chart. What the fuck? Jesus Christ. Brexit moment. How much is Brexit responsible for this? I know it's responsible for it in part, but how much? Because I'm seeing a very wide range of answers. I might have to do some more research into this. This is because there's no regulation or price controls. This is in fact a Brexit moment. If only you guys were an American. Over here, all you have to do is stomp the ground really hard, and oil starts to pull up in your yard. Everyone has a little generator that they just keep filled up. You know, I only learned this the other day. Did you know that there is an infinitely permanent, or like an eternally permanent amount of coal on the planet? Like no more coal is being made. More oil is being made. Apparently the, for a while, all the plant matter that got crushed into coal, we didn't have a particular kind of bacteria, and then a new kind of bacteria came about that digests it, and stuff turns into oil now. But like, now that that bacteria exists, it will never turn into coal. Ever. Like that's it. It cannot be made anymore, you know? Which is interesting. I mean, coal has to be, like, universally one of the rarest materials in existence, right? Because it can only be a byproduct of carbon life, and, you know, Earth's kind of monopolized that to our knowledge for now. I watched that YouTube video too. Hey, me too. Gold is more rare in the universe? Okay, whatever. I heard Charles might change his name to George as king. Yeah, normally when you become the monarch, you take the name of like a, I don't think you have to, but you generally take the name of a previous nominal line. Now what do we do to King George's, folks? Hey, get your bayonets, Freddy. He's Charles III, they announced it. Ah, that's less fun. No! You fucking liberals, stop! I know Hamilton is a lib production, but oh my god, why would anyone take from this production the pro-monarch... All of Hamilton was about people who, if they had been given the chance, would have slaughtered the royal family. All of the fucking people. Oh, is this a joke? Wait, no, it's not. Oh, no, it's not. They're verified. Yeah. All the named characters in Hamilton would have lined up the royal family for the fucking gallows. Actually, I guess Hamilton himself was pretty chummy with the British aristocracy after the end of the war, so never mind. They're actually celebrating the revisionist federalist tendency to get along with British oligarchs and aristocrats. Wasn't that part of the divide in the Founding Fathers? Yes. Hamilton's hardly going to celebrate the Queen's death because that would alienate a lot more people. Does anyone else think it's a little bit fucked up that it's alienating to, like, be anti-monarchy? I mean, it's, pardon my current year meme, it is literally the 21st century. I mean, it's like, oh yeah, oh, I wouldn't want to be divisive and be against the concept of a monarchy. Yeah, oh, sorry, my apologies. I didn't realize I was in mixed company with monarchists. What the fuck? Jesus Christ. Jesus. God, yeah, it's really weird. Being anti-monarchy is fine. Cheering death is kind of, I don't know. You must be new to this stream. Welcome. Did you sub today? Hello. It's good to have you here. Oh, yeah, we would never grave dance here. Oh, man. America should celebrate by dumping tea in the... What's the... Anytime anything happens in England, Americans fucking catapult cartons of tea into the... Okay. All right. Liz tried to have Thatcher to invade South Africa to reinforce apartheid. This article is fucking blocked, man. I think a lot of people dislike the monarchy but still like the queen herself. Yeah, that's how they fucking get you. Sorry, guys, it's a fucking monarchy. It's like a billionaire. The estate is worth billions, right? For the royal family, not her personally, but the estate of the royal family is worth billions. Incredibly powerful political figure, like enormously influential, has the ears of people around the world. Not literally, I mean like they listen to her. Just like, oh, but she's nice. Whatever. Vosh, support for the monarchy still polls at like 60% over the past 2 years. So yes, being anti-monarchy is a hot take in the UK. That is actually psychotic. That is genuinely deranged. I hope you know that. The mental illness of the English people is not going to escape my criticism today. That is fucking insane. That is absolutely fucking insane. Genuinely psychotic. Absolutely psychotic. Yeah, how do the French feel about that? UK media is all rightist gutter trash. Yeah, I've never seen a take from a fucking Brit Bonger newspaper I didn't hate. It's Bernie's birthday? Of course it is. In Scandinavian countries, the approval rating's in the 80% area, Vosh. King of Norway approval. I don't know much about the institutional or cultural power of the Norwegian monarchy. The present monarch is King Harald V, who's reigned since 1991. Whatever. I'm gonna look into this later, man. Fucking monarchy. Fucking Europeans. Fucking Europeans. I fucking hate you. I fucking hate you, degenerates. I'm so fucking glad that my forebears flew over on our fucking Air One jets over to America, got along with the Native Americans, and then established a world superpower, and then invented nukes, and then nuked Japan, and are now single-handedly more economically powerful than your entire continent, okay? I fucking hate you people. Holy shit. It's like, It's you guys are literally like the abusive family we got away from. Like, we leave because you guys are all like creepy and fucking homophobic or whatever, and then 20 years later we go back to a family reunion and you guys still have fucking monarchs. You still have fucking monarchs. Why? What the fuck? Jesus Christ. Stop. You have capitalism. We all have capitalism. We don't have monarchs. We have an oligarchy, like a good, sensible, post-feudal country, okay? Marx could not have predicted how long you people would have clung on to your fucking monarchies. Oh my God. Jesus. Bosch is just jealous of the UK's healthcare. Listen, I run an AC all day, and I have a pretty beefy computer, okay? Whatever money I lose in not having proper healthcare over here is regained by me not having to pay $1 per kilowatt second with my electronic equipment, okay? That's, listen, all right? The cost differential is rebalancing quickly. You know, the... we're righting the wrongs. Oh, I know, Galley. I'm sorry. I know they're gonna be insufferable. Oh, people on my Twitter are mad over this one. Obviously, I'm laughing. You know, Queen Elizabeth II died and you're laughing. But people are really mad over this one. Look at this. Queen of the United Kingdom and other Commonwealth realms. Look at this. Her legacy, her reign is like a scar, like death itself dragged a scythe over the world. Look at all these places on earth that she had royal dominion over. Actually insane. Genuinely insane. They did say the sun never set in the British Empire. Yeah. Yeah, sure. Finland's the best country. Also, they've got a hot PM. Every country I've lived in other than the US is on this list, lol. Yeah, I'm glad that the United States and India are uncucked enough to not be part of the fucking Commonwealth after we broke free. Thank God. Can you imagine if India stayed a part of the Commonwealth? God. Yeah, her death does signify kind of like the book closing on that era of English imperialism. You know what I mean? There are only like 22 countries that weren't invaded by the empire. Yeah. Just so you know, you can be a Republican in the Commonwealth. Yeah, I know that. I still hate the Commonwealth. India is still part of the Commonwealth. Wait, they are? Wait, I didn't know that. No! Under the London Declaration, India agreed that when it became a republic in January 1950, it would remain in the Commonwealth and accept the British sovereign as a symbol of the free association of its independent member nations and as such the head of the Commonwealth? No! All right, I take it back. America is the only real country. Listen, okay? There are two countries, okay? There's America, and then there's England / post-England world, okay? That's it. That's all we have. What the fuck? The only uncucked country. We need like a way down south in the land of Dixie type song for the British, but like one that slaps as hard, you know, because 18th century war jingles were very gay. And we need like a zippy one. We need a zippy one. Why do Indians love the UK? I don't know, man. Keep in mind that India right now is a pretty right-wing country, and right-wing countries do have a tendency to have like a weird kind of love-hate relationship with authoritarian governments that have fucked them over in the past. Keep in mind, you see a lot of this in Eastern Europe, because there are a lot of like Nazis and Soviets, aka Nazis, in Eastern Europe that like romanticize getting fucked over by the people who fucked them over. You know, like, It's complicated. It's complicated. Yeah, Modi's a literal fascist. Yeah. Not good. It's not good. Not good. No, Black and Tans isn't our song, guys. I think it's because of pre-existing trade relationships. Yeah, those roots go deep. Anyway, people got mad at me for this one. I don't see anyone as mad. I remember seeing at least one person who was mad. Well, being mad is really about a feeling. Well, she reigned over an era of British decolonialism as ceremonial power. Oh, this the lib reigning. You say reigned as if she was the dictator of all these territories instead of a glorified mascot. Why do people pretend that the British monarchy doesn't have power? Why do they do that? They didn't want those countries to leave, though. Yeah, I think it's funny when people talk about, like, post-World War II Britain giving up its colonies as though that was some kind of willing decision on their part. Oh, yeah, like they gave up India, you know? Oh, yeah, Hitler was a bad guy. However, we do celebrate him for seceding France, Poland, you know, Hungary, you know. It's like, thank you, Hitler. He did reside over an era of decolonization as he, you know, gave back these territories. Well, yeah, he didn't do it on purpose. He didn't want to do it. States can voluntarily join or leave the Commonwealth. Please, please don't retreat on me on this one. Guys, does imperialism begin and end at, like, military conquest? Of course not. The Commonwealth, anyone who believes that the Commonwealth is not a direct product of English imperialism, I have no idea what we're going on about. I don't even know what we're talking about at that point. I don't even know what we're doing anymore. You know, of course it is, you know? I mean, it's like the decayed zombie corpse of the British Empire, right? Like, it used to be they controlled the world through military might, and then after World War II, that kind of fell apart. So now they have, like, this vestigial, like, neo-colonial trade network with ceremonial elements, and it's like, you know, I mean, it's just what they can get away with now. It's not like they became any more nice over the past 100 years. You know, material conditions changed. If England had the power to still rule over the world with an iron fist, it would be doing that. They don't. Nobody does. No single country can anymore, thanks to nuclear weapons. So Brexit really isn't a reaction to the end of empire. Yeah, of course it is. Yeah. The whole reason Brexit happened was because post-colonial British dipshits still feel emasculated by the end of empire, and as such, they don't want to be a part of the European Union because they feel the secession of their national sovereignty is some kind of, like, attack on the British character, you know? Like Brexit, the insane decision to go forward with Brexit can be tied back to the national trauma of no longer getting to, like, rate 15 like Indian people per pound of spice that you can ship back to England to not use in your food, you know? Bosh, I know you probably don't like the monarchy. However, don't you think it's a little bit too soon to say stuff like Rip Bozo, it's still a person who died, show a bit of respect? Nope. I assume that's bait because I have no idea how a person could follow my stream and not know my attitude towards this thing, but I think celebrating the death of people who are bad is actually good. I think that's actually a good thing. How dare you politicize the death of the monarch? She could have simply not been the monarch. You know, she always had that right. If she wanted to step down, she could have. Or, you know, dismantle the institution. Or at the very least, call for the dismantling of the institution. Lord knows she had enough time. She had, like, 80 years. But... Do you have any idea how based... Oh, 70 years. Do you have any idea how based it would be if, at some point, like... If some point in the past couple decades or whatever... She had done some speech where she was like, look, I've been here for a while. I think this institution's rotten to the core. I don't think that we serve any purpose for the British people anymore, and I'm done. Yeet. Your boy's done. And then left. That'd have been pretty fucking based. That'd have been pretty good. Been pretty fucking based. People would have been super mad. But what are they going to do? She's still going to be rich and powerful after she steps down, you know? Isn't that... What power did she have? What? She's the Queen of England. She's the Queen of England. Charles I was beheaded by Parliament, and I hope they continue the trend. What did Charles I even do? Oh, the English Civil War. Yeah. You gotta fuck up pretty bad for Parliament to behead you. By provoking the Second English Civil War, even while defeated in captivity, Charles was held responsible for unjustifiable bloodshed. The secret engagement treaty with the Scots was considered particularly unpardonable. A more prodigious treason, said Oliver Cromwell. Ah, Oliver Cromwell. Hello, hello. The Lord Protector. This guy was the king who wasn't a king, right? He was the guy who was like, listen, we've had enough of kings, okay? So I'm now going to be a new office called Grand Poobah. And as Grand Poobah, I will be a hereditary monarch. And I'm going to be really bad and evil. But I don't like kings. Lord Protector. Yeah, Grand Poobah. Yeah. He tried to genocide the Irish Catholics. Ooh, that's not good. Cromwell was essentially a fascist. A fascist before fascism. He literally banned Christmas. Okay, that's funny, though. He literally banned Christmas? Okay, that's kind of base, though, just for being, like, the supervillain, you know? Like, that, you're living in the moment, all right? God, why does no one know history? I'm American! Sorry we can't all memorize the fucking 850-year British royal line. Or, and after Sir Padangshah the 17th mysteriously fell ill at a banquet, and Sir Mullifew the 8th died in a hunting accident, Lord Cromwopplebiffin assumed the monarchy and became King Flifflely. I don't know, shut up. Fuck you, I don't care. I don't even have all the US presidents memorized. Fun fact, if Lizzie II had made it about 2 more years, she would have been the longest reigning monarch in world history, but she's still beaten by Louis XIV at 72 years, La Mal France Day winning. Yeah, you can't beat Louis XIV. Are you kidding me? You can't Huey the Louis. Look at this fucking guy. This guy is like the epitome of monarchy. No one can be more monarchical than this guy. Fucking look at him. It makes sense that somebody who looks and acts like this would be the longest living monarch, because he's clearly some kind of like imp god who arrived on Earth as like a manifestation of the concept of monarchy. Also, didn't he assume the monarchy when he was like 2 years old or some shit? So it makes sense that he would when he was five? No, wait, when did he actually assume the he was actually four. He was four. Oh, yep. Sensing imminent death, Louis XIII decided to put his affairs in order in the spring of 1643 when Louis XIV was 4 years old. Yeah. Look, he was so fucking gay, even as a kid. Jesus Christ. Look at how bullied he would have been if he wasn't, you know, capable of beheading your entire family with an errant hand gesture. The way they used to paint people is so fucking funny, dude. Not gay is French, but you repeat yourself. He once said, I am the state. It's Louis XIV. Bosh, but he was super conservative. I know, it's Louis XIV. I know who Louis XIV. Yeah, he's one of the most famous monarchs. Like, yeah, this guy was, yeah. He is the everything. I know, I'm not standing him. I'm just, he's the most monarch, yeah. It's, look at him. Of course he's the state. Look at him. Jesus! How'd he die, though? Didn't he die peacefully? He was a pretty strong monarch, wasn't he? Not good, mind you. Just, like, keep the houses together kind of monarch. Yeah, old age, yeah. He called himself the Sun King? That's so fucking dope, dude. Fuck. That's so fucking good. Holy shit. Why the fuck did Elizabeth II not have, like, some insane, like, megalomaniacal title? The Moon Queen. The Blood Pudding Queen. I don't fucking know. Few rulers in world history have commemorated themselves in so grand a manner as Louis. He cultivated his image as the Sun King, the center of the universe without equal. Fuck, I love this guy. Louis used court ritual and the arts to validate and augment his control over France. With his support, Colbert established from the beginning of Louis's personal reign a centralized and institutionalized system for creating and perpetuating the royal image. The king was thus portrayed largely in majesty or at war, notably against Spain. The portrayal of the monarch was to be found in numerous media of artistic expression, such as painting, sculpture, theater, dance, music, and the almanacs, that diffused royal propaganda to the population at large. Over his lifetime, Louis commissioned numerous works of art to portray himself, among them over 300 formal portraits. I respect this guy because I think he was unique as monarchs go in that even though he ruled over the peasantry, he put a lot of time and effort into like convincing them that he deserved to be thought of as the God King. You know what I mean? Like the concept of monarchical propaganda seems a bit weird because we tend to think of monarchs as people who just sit like fat in a castle and nobody can do anything about it because they have an army around him. But he really wanted to be a diva. Yeah. Louis loved ballet and frequently danced in court ballets during the early half of his reign. In general, Louis was an eager dancer who performed 80 roles in 40 major ballets. Oh my God, he's so French. He sometimes danced leading roles that were suitably royal or godlike, such as Neptune, Apollo, or the Sun. At other times, he would adopt mundane roles before appearing at the end as the lead role. Oh, that's so funny. Imagine being like a fucking French aristocrat or merchant noble and watching a play that has Louis XIV in it. And he shows up early as like a peasant boy or something. And everyone's like, ooh, the king, you know? And then at the end, like the lead shows up and it's also him. And everyone's like, ooh, yes! Oh, what a devilish twist! He played both parts! What delightful tomfoolery! Dude, no, I'm joking, but I'm not joking. Like, that was probably definitely, absolutely what happened, right? That had to be what happened. Except instead of French accents, they would have French accents instead of British accents, yeah. It is considered that at all times he provided his roles with sufficient majesty and drew the limelight with his flair for dancing. Ballet dancing was used by Louis as a political tool to hold power over the state. Fuck, man. It's like a dictatorship by a RuPaul drag race contestant. Jesus Christ. Like every week there are like show trials where they do a fucking Vogue off, and whoever serves the least cunt, like that political official gets executed or something. I'm sorry. It's just he got Versailles built, right? That was him, right? Or was that somebody else? Yeah, he also got Versailles built. How much did Versailles cost? It's $1 trillion, right? No, it must have been 1 quadrillion. Hold on. I'm sorry. Wiki. Versailles. If I remember correctly, Versailles like bankrupted the country. Which, to be fair, it looks like the kind of place that would bankrupt the country, man. This is... So, we've met the man. Now let's meet the crib. Jesus Christ! Look at those low-hanging chandeliers. It's worth $50 billion today. God damn. Trump? Nah, Trump tries to fake this style. That's the difference. Trump just wants gold-plated toilets. This was the absolute pinnacle of monarchical decadence. Nothing else comes close to this, I don't think. The Versailles is like a special... Yeah. Special kind of place. It smelled like shit. Versailles? Weren't there people like shitting in the hallways because the place was so big that there would just be like 10,000 people in Versailles at once or something? Because they're French, yeah. Well, obviously, like, they're French, too, yeah. Yeah. You're telling me you guys don't want to shit in the infinitely wealthy palace of the god, of the Sun King? Look at the estate, man. This was painted in 1668. Can you imagine, like, seeing this at a display or something? Or like a private commission? It's like, oh, so this is where he lives. And, like, you own one bucket that you collect, like, cow milk in or something? Fucking Anne Orlando. God. Good Lord, this is awful looking. Nah, I think the reason why I like Versailles so much is because it's a perfect representation of what it is. Funnily enough, there's no pretense. You know, for the most decadent building in the world, there's no pretense. It is exactly what it claims to be. Which I appreciate. Model of the former ambassador's staircase. God damn, dude. What is this architecture called? Rococo? Or is that something else? Baroque? Baroque. My art history chops are a bit lacking, I'm sorry. Like, look at this. The Salon of Mars. Just like, yeah, dude. What are you bringing all that gold and paint in there for? Oh, yeah, I'm just going to, like, I'm working on the ceiling in this one odd side room of, like, the 5,000 rooms in this place. Does every room have a ceiling mural? I mean, a lot of them do. Look at this. They're not shitty paintings either. This is all, like, Sistine Chapel shit. I mean, if nothing else, it's a building fitting for somebody who calls himself a Sun King. There's the king's bedchamber with their goofy little fucking beds. The queen's bedchamber. The gilded cabinet of Marie Antoinette. Billiard room of many. It had 16,000 gardeners working every day. That's a lot of people. All right, we gotta stop. Weren't a decent number of monarchs literally insane from all the inbreeding? Yes. Though the inbreeding madness takes a while to come about. It's not usually like a one or two generation thing. Like a lot of the royal families, like in Spain or whatever, where that happened, it's like direct inbreeding over a while. And then you have people who are like physically degenerating, you know? Yeah. You have to commit to the practice. Yeah. You can't just engage in some casual incest, okay? You have to be committed. Who's the most incest guy? Charles II of Spain? That was the most guy, right? Charles II of Spain? Yeah. You know, not to be ableist or whatever, but if nothing else, it's a good, like, a cautionary tale. Whereas, heraldry. Oh god, I don't know if I want to parse this. Yeah. Look, Mariana and Philip IV produced him, but Mariana was of Mariana Anna and the Ferdinand III, but they were together too, and then if you look at it for a bit, a couple of lines there shouldn't be. Yeah. Historians Will and Ariel Durant famously describe Charles as short, lame, epileptic, senile, and completely bald before 35, always on the verge of death, but repeatedly baffling Christendom by continuing to live. I aspire to be this. The degree to which inbreeding is responsible for... if anything you do in your life baffles Christendom, I feel like you're setting a high bar. The autopsy? Where does it mention the autopsy? His autopsy revealed his sole remaining testicle was atrophied. The autopsy records his heart was the size of a peppercorn, his lungs corroded, his intestines rotten and gangrenous. He had a single testicle black as coal, and his head was full of water. Probably a little bit hyperbolized. This was back in the day when a doctor could write down, Eath... fallen to the wasting illness, and then close the book and get like stay on the king's commission. So you know, we have limited information to work off of. Fantastic stuff. Who was the opposite of this guy? It was that proto-fascist from Russia who was super strong and died of a hernia because he like physically stopped the roof of a train car from collapsing in on him. Who was that guy again? No, not Rasputin. No, Rasputin was the fucking witch doctor dude or whatever. When did Rasputin die of a hernia? He was assassinated. You're just saying Rasputin because I said guy in Russia who died. What? Rasputin was assassinated. What do you mean died of a hernia? Okay. Who am I actually thinking of? The song about Rasputin is about how he died by assassination. Is it Peter the Great? No, it was not Peter the Great. This guy looks like he couldn't lift a fucking rock. Who was the guy? It was Alexander II? No, not Alexander II. Alexander III, maybe? Yeah, okay, the third. You can tell it's him because he looks like that. He's a beefy, beefy guy. We went over this on the stream before, but I just thought we should contrast Charles II of Spain with this dude. He He was like a strong man, like a strong man, you know. Where's the injury? Illness and death. On 29th of October 1888, the imperial train derailed in an accident at Burki. At the moment of the crash, the imperial family was in the dining car. Its roof collapsed, and Alexander held its remains on his shoulder as the children fled outdoors. The onset of his kidney failure, not hernia, was later attributed to the blunt trauma suffered in this incident. He was a strong man, and literally the train derailed, and he saved the royal family by holding aloft the roof as they fled to safety. Now, this guy was a massive piece of shit. However, that's pretty good. That's good there. You know, that's a heroic fucking death. Yeah, the fascism fueled him. Wasn't he pro-democracy? I don't get the best memory. He did a lot of crappy shit, you know. No, yeah, he was anti-democracy, wasn't he? Alexander was extremely strong. He tore packs of cards in half with his bare hands to entertain his children. When the Austrian ambassador in St. Petersburg said Austria would mobilize 2 or 3 army corps against Russia, he twisted a silver fork into a knot and threw it onto the plate of the ambassador. He said, "That is what I am going to do to your 2 or 3 army corps." Fuck yeah, dude. Absolutely. That's what we need. Fuck politics, okay? You know, fuck politics, fuck policy, fuck ethics, fuck philosophy, fuck everything, okay? Return the world to a state of warring feudal kingdoms where you have fancy pants sun kings who do ballet to reinforce their totalitarian dictatorship up against Russian strongmen who hold aloft trains to save their families, okay? Fuck everything else. Just bring everything back to aesthetics. Abandon all politics. Return to tradition, okay? Yeah, that's why I support Fetterman. If any current running U.S. politician would be capable of holding aloft the roof of a collapsing imperial train, it would indeed be Fetterman. He's our guy. Isn't that what fascism is? I am effectively describing fascism, yes. Aesthetics-obsessed worship of the perceived might of our rulers. On the other hand, Fetterman. You know, they say a U.S. Republican senator once met Fetterman at a fundraising dinner, and he said, "I am going to lower the taxes on the rich 2 or 3 times." And Fetterman took a silver fork and twisted it into a pretzel, threw it at the senator's plate, and said, "That is what I am going to do to your tax cuts." He's so fucking big. All right, enough time wasting. Let's look at people crying over the Queen. Give me the links. Who could physically stop him from just taking office? Yeah, he could just walk in there even if he lost, and nobody could remove him from the seat. All U.S. flags are going to be flown at half-mast. Yeah, it's expected. World leader dying, blah, blah. Not surprising. Argentina TV celebration.
¡Qué hija de puta! ¡Terminó de una buena vez! ¡Fuerte aplauso para Satanás que se la llevó! No está más. La vieja se murió. Los ingleses lo tapan. Está muerta, dura como un quebracho tirada en la cama, la vieja de mierda.
This is actually the resolution that it was broadcast to live to Argentinian audiences as well. You know, this is just what they have to deal with.
Se ha terminado y yo les prometí que íbamos a brindar y vamos a brindar a comer sanguchitos. Esta basura británica, esta inmundicia de Lucifer. Esta basura amazona ha salido del planeta Tierra y es una buena noticia para todos, por fin.
What's your take on the Falklands? You know what my take on the Falklands is, come on.
Se muere alguien correcto en la vida, ¿no? Tanto muere... Mira. Vamos a brindar un poquito por la muerte de la basura de la reina de Inglaterra.
Could you elaborate? Okay, I don't know that much about it, but as I understand it, basically Thatcher woke up one morning and bolted out of her virgin blood-filled coffin, looked at her poll numbers and went, "Cor blimey, I'm not that popular, am I, right now, innit, eh, what?" And then decided that there was some petty legal dispute that she could take advantage of politically, or something like that. Vosh, no? Oh, okay, I'm totally wrong then. That's not what happened. I might be thinking of something else. What actually happened with the Falklands? Please look it up. All right. Wait, was I right about Thatcher and the virgin blood-soaked coffin? Okay, yeah, okay. I wasn't totally off. Okay, not the islands itself. I mean the conflict. Falklands War. 10-week undeclared war between Argentina and the UK in 82 over two British-dependent territories, the Falkland Islands and its territorial dependent. What's the population of this place? Are we just fighting over dirt? How many people live here? Population 2016, a bit over 3,000. Okay, there are people here. People's lives matter. So it's probably back then fewer people, but you know. Argentina invaded and occupied the Falkland Islands, followed by the invasion of South Georgia the next day. On the 5th of April, the British government dispatched a naval task force to engage the Argentine Navy and Air Force before making an amphibious assault on the islands. Why did I remember the British starting this conflict? I guess I totally misremembered. Okay. In total, 649 Argentine military personnel, 255 British military personnel, and 3 Falkland Islanders died during the hostilities. Falkland Islanders, who have inhabited the island since the early 19th century, predominantly descended from settlers and strongly favor British sovereignty, neither state officially declared war. Well, I'm sure I can read more into this in the future, but from what I'm reading right here, it seems like the British were in the right. An authoritarian Argentine government just randomly fucking decided to assert national power by conquering these territories. The people who were there didn't want that. You know, however many there were, there were still people there. England put them in their place. Okay. All right, never mind. It was the Argentine dictator who wanted to conquer the Falklands to gain popularity in the economy. Okay, I knew somebody started this conflict over fucking polling numbers. I just didn't. Okay, yeah. Thank you for correcting me. The Argentine dictators were all pretty much mini Hitlers. Well, I mean, they might have literally been, right? Argentina, 80s? Yeah.
De puta del marido, ahora se muere ella y estamos a pleno festejando por la muerte de todo puto inglés de mierda que pertenezca a esa corona inmunda, pirata, ladrona, genocida, asesina que ha sido un tormento. Esta nazi hija de puta que de chiquita era admiradora de Hitler y hacía el saludo nazi, por fin ha llegado a su fin.
Nice. Oh yeah, we backed the Argentine dictator. The U.S. loves backing Latin American fascists. That's like our favorite thing. What is this? Why are people just linking random videos?
Who's in charge of Britain?
Mapman.
Well, it's the Prime Minister, isn't it? The one we voted for? Actually, no, he isn't. Not only is the Prime Minister not in charge of Britain, but we didn't even vote for him. The Prime Minister is officially just an advisor to the real head honcho.
Me!
Yes, an old lady lucky enough to be descended from a family with the most violent army is our head of state. It's officially her country and her laws. Except you know that's not really how it works. Our parliament is a baffling thousands of years old institution that's been around for hundreds of years. And it's changed so much that the word officially means diddly squat. So how is the country actually run? What does the Prime Minister do? Who does the government? Why am the there backbenchers? Government how Home Secretary there is? Parliamentary where cabinet reshuffle opposition right honourable what? Britain is a democracy, which means we, the people, decide how the country is run.
But instead of squeezing 64 million people into the House of Commons, we have 650 people representing all of us. How are they choosed?
The country has been carefully carefully divided into 650 constituencies, each one containing roughly 70,000 voters.
Every 5 years, there's a general election. We put an X next to the person we like best, then the person with the most votes becomes our constituency's Member of Parliament, or MP.
Now, even though technically anyone can put themselves up for election, and they often do, they're almost always a member of a political party. But what is a political party?
Broadly speaking, it's a group of people that all feel the same way about how the country should be run. They have a party headquarters and a logo and a favourite colour. If you're a member of one of these parties, you're much more likely to get voted for because people know what you stand for. And political parties have got money to help with posters and leaflets and things.
There's nothing in the rule book that says there needs to be such thing as political parties. They've just naturally come about. In theory, you could have a parliament made up entirely of independent partyless MPs.
It's just never happened, and they probably wouldn't agree on anything.
So that's how the House of Commons gets its 650 MPs. And now this is where she comes in. The Queen politely asks one of the MPs to be her Prime Minister. This is a tradition that dates back to the years of King George I, who needed an advisor to help run the country because he only spoke German. Officially, the Queen can pick whomever she likes, but so far, she's always gone for the leader of the party with the most MPs.
This is so naturally disgusting to me. I don't care how it actually plays out in reality. The fact that the official, like, by the books, real, formal method is like, ah, yes, the Queen chooses, you know, I just, disgusting, revolting.
The Prime Minister then chooses a crack team of his best friends to form the government, a small group of people who do the actual day-to-day running of Britain.
Maybe it feels even more disgusting right now because we're realizing here in America just how much of our democracy relies on people agreeing to gentlemen's agreements. And if you act in bad faith and no longer abide by those gentlemen's agreements, that everything falls apart. It's actually really easy for authoritarians to take charge. So the idea of England having their gentlemen's agreements non-formalized and being done at the behest of a hereditary monarchy is just a little bit too tetchy at the moment.
And coming up with new laws and deciding where to spend our money and deciding how to get our money, etc., etc. The Prime Minister's job is to decide who does what, swap them around every so often, and give them a massive f***ing if they f*** up. But the government can't do whatever it likes. It has to be kept in check and challenged on every decision it makes. That's mainly the job of the party that came second in the general election. They're called the opposition. They pretend they've got government jobs and show you what they would have done if they'd won instead. Again, there's nothing in the rulebook about any opposition. In fact, the opposition wasn't mentioned in law at all until 1937, when they had to agree how much the leader of the opposition should be paid. So what about the rest of the MPs who don't get a job to represent us, the ordinary folk, in Parliament? And they do this by voting on things. Every time someone comes up with a potential new law, known as a bill, our MPs argue about it for ages and ages and then decide aye or no in a vote.
The ayes to the right, 400!
I will say, leaving aside the fact that all of this is being dictated by centuries-old traditions, I do think that the House of Commons is better than the House of Congress, the House of Representatives. I do believe that. I think that all of our representatives should have to sit shoulder to shoulder in a bunch of uncomfortable benches and scream at each other as well. I would prefer this to what we have.
Aye or no in a vote.
The ayes to the right, 400.
They use the word aye instead of yes because they're pillocks. In theory, the MPs decide for themselves how to vote, but the slightly depressing news is they're normally told how to vote by the leader of their party. Party leaders employ people literally called whips whose job it is to go around making threats and promises so that MPs vote as they're told. It's the only way you can get more than half of the room to vote the same way. It may seem like an insult to democracy, but the actually, that's pretty hard to justify. Once a bill gets liked by the House of Commons, it gets handed on a piece of paper to the room next door, the House of Lords. But they're really weird and complicated, and I can't be bothered to talk about them right now, so they're a story for another time. Bills get sent back and forth like an onion between the two houses until ultimately one person gets the final say on what becomes a law.
Oh, go on then.
Isn't that insane that we actually live in a monarchy? It's 2000 and something, not 13 something. Gradually over time, the Queen's role has become more and more ceremonial, and she does more and more nothing. Her power still exists, and in theory, the Queen could veto any law she doesn't like. But she knows full well that if she tries to exercise any of her theoretical power and defy the MPs that we, the people, voted for, there'll be an instant revolution and we'll set her palace on fire. It's easy to forget all of this. When there's an election on, the media make it feel like you're choosing a prime minister. But you're not. And you're not choosing a party either. You're choosing a person, your local MP, who just happens to be a member of a party, who just happens to have a party leader. So, who's in charge of Britain? In an official sense, her. In a technical sense, him. In a practical sense, them. In an idealistic sense, us. But the real answer, dunno.
Wait, I want to see, doesn't this guy have a video on the House of Lords? Wait, I want to see that. The House of Lords is the most insane, yes, oh my god, yes. Sorry, not the House of Lords, the Right Honorable, the Lord Spiritual and Temporal of the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland and Parliament Assembled. There we go, sorry.
This episode of Politics Unboring is brought to you by the Great Courses Plus. The House of Lords, or to give it its proper title, the Right Honorable, the Lord Spiritual and Temporal of the United Kingdom of Great... Britain and Northern Ireland in Parliament assembled, .gov.uk, is a big room in that building there, and it's full of lords.
Lords, also known as peers, have a really important job. They look at the ideas that the MPs come up with for new laws and check the fine details to make sure they're just right. If they're not happy, they send them back and say, do it again!
Being a peer is brilliant.
You get to wear fancy red robes, people have to call you Lord something, you get £300 expenses per day, you can fly, you're allowed to sleep during debates, and you get to keep the job for life.
So, how do you get to be one?
1. Be born a hereditary peer. If your dad is a hereditary peer, you get to take his place when he dies. This used to be only for men, but it was changed to include women in 1963, as long as they don't have any brothers. 2. Be an Anglican bishop.
If you're a bishop in the Church of England, you automatically get a seat in the House of Lords, because if you know how to run a church, you know how to run the country.
3. Be chosen by the Prime Minister. Prime Ministers can stuff the House with as many Lords as they like during their time in office. If you want to be picked, though not essential, it helps if you've donated money to their party.
Now, if to you any of this seems surprising or archaic or batshit, then there's good news. There have been some changes over the past few years to drag the House of Lords kicking and screaming into the 19th century.
1. The number of hereditary peers is now limited to 92.
By the way, that doesn't mean there are 92 remaining that we're waiting for to die. When one family dies out, the other lords have a vote to replace them from a pool of about 800 aristocrats. So there will always be 92 of them.
2. Leaders of other religions get to be lords.
The 26 Church of England bishops have now been joined by leaders of other faiths. One Methodist, one Scottish Presbyterian, one Church of Ireland, and 2 rabbis.
3. The Prime Minister has been asked nicely not to give so many peerages. 4. In 2001, they introduced a new way of getting lords into the House. The Appointments Commission. The Appointments Commission's job is to pick people from the real world outside the usual batch of ex-cabinet ministers.
These people's peers are chosen for their skills and experience, such as if they're experts in law, or science, or the arts, or beer.
Thus assuring that the House of Lords is truly representative of the British people it serves, with the exception of the 92 hereditary peers, 26 godbrothers, and 620 life peers chosen by the Prime Minister, who ultimately have the final say on the laws that govern our country despite not being elected, which arguably is a positive thing because it means they're less caught up in party politics and can concentrate on getting the job done, but it also makes them completely unaccountable, and the paltry reforms in 1999 served only to legitimise how inherently undemocratic the entire institution is and delay any meaningful reform for the foreseeable future whilst we continue to labour under the assumption that we live in a democracy and still have a monarch for...
You know what? I can't be bothered to talk about this anymore. The end.
Nice. He does creative bits, but we're not watching those today. All right, well, now we know more about the Right Honourable the Lord Spiritual and Temporal of the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland in Parliament assembled. This is why countries shouldn't be allowed to exist for more than a couple hundred years. If they exist for too long, inevitably they're going to accumulate so much traditional muck that they become completely unviable. This is why, at the end of the day, you know, you have to give credit to Mao Zedong, right? He may have killed tens of millions of people in a startling display of incompetence and, you know, callous disregard for human life, but he also did a little something called the Cultural Revolution, which essentially deleted 4,000 years of Chinese history and started the new... No! That sounds like a joke, but that's actually, like, that was actually the purpose of the Cultural Revolution. China has one of the longest running, it's like the oldest country basically in its current form, and his idea was like this country is so bogged down by cultural weight that we basically just have to torch it all and start new, and you know, especially all the bourgeois elements, of course. Wipe the slate clean. Yeah, too bad Xi Jinping is completely undoing that, but also, the Cultural Revolution had some yikesy moments. There were definitely some yikesy moments in the Cultural Revolution. Like that story of the Chinese government wanting to make red the color of progress. So in some areas of China, they made it so that for street lights, red was the color of go forward and green was the color of stop. And it led to like hundreds of people dying in traffic accidents because they just applied those rules out of nowhere for purely ideological reasons, and they had to change it back. Yeah, I learned that in a Mandalore video, yeah. And it's pretty wacky. Mandalore's a great YouTuber, yeah. No shame. Can we laugh with the Irish right now? You gonna watch the new Jordan Peterson Twitter ban video? No, that's boring. It's literally a 25-minute video of him crying about getting a Twitter ban again. Like, no, no, that's super fucking boring. He's got to come up with new shit. To be fair, Vosh, it's hard to take these criticisms in government structure when y'all have the Electoral College. I didn't put the Electoral College in place, you fucking racist. Pretty interesting, though, right? Great leap forward in the traffic lights in China. 25th of August, 1966. Revolutionary Chinese guards say red is the color of revolution and should be the new green light. The guards plastered posters on the city's walls today, which said that red was the color of revolution. Yeah, this is from then. This article was written then. Like, it's from the archive, see? So this was written when this happened. And should be used as a signal for traffic to go forward. Observers said the posters did not appear to be authorized by the government, but appeared to be a suggestion of individual groups of guards. Red guards today raided Peking homes, accusing the inhabitants of opposing the ideology of Mao Zedong and the Cultural Revolution. Crowds cheered as the students smashed windows, overturned furniture, tossed possessions which they considered luxurious or bourgeois on the street. We have to talk about the Cultural Revolution sometime, man, because there was some wacky stuff. Some wacky stuff went down that we haven't even really talked about, you know? Basically, Vosh, millions were killed during the Cultural Revolution. Yeah, it was pretty wacky. Basically, Mao was like, we need to get rid of 4,000 years of cultural and traditional weight. And the best way to do that is to give unchecked political power to the group of people most contemptuous towards tradition, college students. And basically, you had college students acting as like revolutionary cells all over the country, like dictating orders to literal military detachments to like purge their communities of bourgeois degeneracy and stuff. I mean, it was like, imagine going to your local university and going to their like gay straight alliance or like LGBTQ plus club or their like anti-racism squad, what, yeah, fucking whatever, and then like giving them like 400 guards in like a province with a bunch of villages in it and telling them to snuff out bad ideas. Like, fuck. Yeah, what happened is pretty much what you would expect to happen. In others, they held up items like strings of pearls and Western-style clothes and shoes for the crowd to ridicule before hurling the articles out of the houses. The students put up posters at the entrance to a park criticizing young couples who sat in lonely places giggling and doing things which burn the eyes. Ha! Fucking, student cells, dude. These, because you know that all of the people, all the students who were doing the Revolutionary Committee bullshit were like the losers, right? All the gigachads in China at the time were just like getting laid, you know? Like, if there were college students in China who like didn't give a shit about this and just wanted like fucking pussy or whatever, they're doing their own thing, you know? The people who are on these revolutionary committees are the losers, the people who would be hall monitors. So, of course, they're like, you must purge this this bourgeois decadent behavior of holding hands in park, you know? Glorious Mao Zedong thought with Marxist-Leninist characteristics demands we all keep our hands to ourselves while in public. The poster said these activities and others, such as sitting up late at night writing love letters, must stop. God, it's like giving left Twitter the keys to the revolution. Holy shit. And here's why, just, you know, all those people on Twitter who like start sending each other death threats and doing self-harm over age gap discourse and whether it's problematic to ship 25-year-olds with 23-year-olds in media. Okay. Just imagine giving these people a gun and limitless government power. Jesus fucking Christ. How the logistics of this even happened? Was it just like stochastic terrorism? I mean, it was very complicated, of course, but like generally speaking, just the local revolutionary activity and decision making was often put in the hands of like revolutionary cells that were pulled from student groups, like literal college students. Check out the violent struggles in China during the 60s. Bunch of lefties fighting each other and killing tens of thousands of people. Ah, yes, left Twitter before Twitter. Literally, like, listen to this, okay? Violent struggle, violent conflicts between different factions during the Cultural Revolution. During much of the fighting, weapons were either acquired by the rebel groups through raids on arms depot or directly supplied from local military establishments. Weapons used in armed conflicts included some 18.77 million guns, though some say one-tenth of that, 2.72 million grenades, 14,000 cannons, 250,000 dead, or 7 million injured or permanently disabled. Left Twitter before Twitter, man. But that's always been the history of China, right? The history of China has always been like, you know, in 628, this family and this family had a dispute over like leek prices at the local market. The subsequent civil war lasted 8 years and claimed 50 billion lives. And then somehow the state continues to exist. That's the thing that I don't get about China, man. You take a look at all the fucking death tolls they have in their respective conflicts. Somehow the state continues to exist in spite of all of this, you know? You're like, I swear to God, dude, this is like a testament to Chinese persistence. Any European state would have balkanized 15 times over with the shit China has gone through. You really think a country like Germany or England or France wouldn't have broken into 17 constituent countries if they had to go through something like the Cultural Revolution? Absolutely not. No. But somehow China continues to... To be fair, China's fallen apart a lot of the time. Yeah, but it's like that art where when pottery falls apart, you mend it with gold, right? China just keeps coming back together. Like, China breaks, but it keeps coming back, you know? They're built different. What does Balkanize mean? Well, like the Balkans, like Yugoslavia and stuff. Basically, it's basic dialectics. You take a country with 15,000 internal schisms, you hit it lightly with a little ball-peen hammer, and watch as it fractures into 10,000 microscopic ethnostates that all want nothing more than the absolute genocide of their neighbors. Also known as Austria-Hungary. Listen, it's been known to happen, okay? Europeans, you know how it is. Yeah, Kintsugi, that's the gold pottery art, yeah. The problem with looking at TikToks is no matter how neat they are, they always have fucking copyright music. We get the gist of this one. How to achieve Maoism, it's only 1 minute long. This is going to be reactionary, I can feel it.
Step 1. Conquer all of China from oppressive warlords. Step 2. Encourage education and increase the literacy rate from 20% to 70%. Step 3. Greatly improve women's rights in Chinese society. Step 4. Increase the life expectancy with improved health care for rural peasants. Step 5. Encourage people to voice their concerns about the government.
Oh, no.
Step 6. Imprison and murder 100,000 of your critics. Step 7. Send the bourgeois and landlords to Laogai camps.
Okay.
Step 8. Expand agricultural production by overworking collectivized farmers with faulty practices. Step 9. Expand steel production by taking laborers out of agriculture and into making useless pig iron. Step 10. Create the biggest man-made famine in history.
但是等等,还有更多.
Step 11. Drop a new book. Step 12. Transform the nation's youth into an unorganized mass paramilitary. Step 13. Destroy artifacts to be rid of the old. Step 14. Murder their teachers to be rid of the old. Step 15. Murder their elders to be rid of the old. Step 16. Die at the age of 82.
True. If only we had a leader of this national strength and character. Just forgot about the Sparrow genocide. Oh, dude, if you were to do a video in that style, counting all of the atrocities of Mao's China, it would never end. It would just be like, the problem is that video we just watched gave us a new line of text every 10 seconds, and archaeologists and historians are discovering a new Mao tragedy every 8 seconds. So the video would actually be updating and expanding faster than you could consume it. You could only ever reach the end by watching it at 2x speed. There's no other way. The Red Guard did cannibalism on political enemies, by the way. Yeah, who doesn't? Guanxi Massacre? Series of events involving lynching and direct massacre in Guangxi during the Cultural Revolution. Estimated death toll from 100,000 to 150,000. There are nothing in China has ever caused the death of fewer than 100,000 people. No event in Chinese history has ever led to fewer than that number of people dying. Methods of slaughter included beheading, beating, live burial, stoning, drowning, boiling, and disemboweling. Massive human cannibalism occurred, even though no famine existed. At least 100 people were eaten by others. Thousands participated in the cannibalism. Yeah, cool. After the Cultural Revolution, people who were involved in the massacre or cannibalism received minor punishments during the Bolon Banzeng period in Wuzhan County, where at least 38 people were eaten. 15 participants were prosecuted, receiving 14 years in prison, where 91 members of the Chinese Communist Party were expelled from the party, and 39 non-party officials were either demoted or had a salary cut. Although the cannibalism was sponsored by local offices of the Communist Party and militia, no direct evidence suggests that anyone in the National Communist Party leadership, including Mao Zedong, endorsed the cannibalism or even knew about it. Nice. I'm learning a lot of cool stuff today. We're just kind of bouncing all over the place, but we're learning a lot of cool stuff. A lot of wacky stuff. A lot of goofy goober shit right here. Yes, we are. No CGP Grey. The pig iron shit was still the most insane stuff. No, stop. Chat. What is pig iron? It refers to the quality of the iron. I'm not a metallurgist. Basically, the gist of it was that at the time, most of China was like just subsistence farmers, and as part of the plan to revolutionize and industrialize China, the Communist Party was just like, yeah, okay, we're now going to have iron quotas for all these farmers. So making iron is actually pretty difficult. Like, pig iron's not that good, and modern everything kind of requires better iron than that, because it's modern. Like, it's not, like, medieval period, you know? It's not great for the stuff we need metal for. So basically, it was just like, let's get our millions of subsistence farmers who live off the crops that they produce to make metal that will be too low quality to produce anything with instead. How will we feed them? We won't. And then 40 million people starve to death. 20 to 40 million people. Yeah, very, very smart. Yeah, a lot of people. That's so many. Yeah, it's a lot of people. They melted down farming equipment to make the pig iron. Yeah. Not great. Donald Trump reacts to Queen Elizabeth's death. When I saw this at first, I thought it was, I thought it was going to be the RGB meme.
Queen Elizabeth II died, quote, peacefully Thursday afternoon at Balmoral Castle, the Queen's privately owned property in Scotland, surrounded by her family, according to a statement from Buckingham Palace. Former President Donald Trump reacted in several posts on his social media platform. The former president said, quote, we send our sincere...
This is boring. I wanted him to talk. I wanted him in front of a camera. Nice. Nice. All right, well, we've been meandering for a while now. I don't know.
Queen Elizabeth II was the rock on which modern Britain was built. Our country has grown and flourished under her reign. Today, the crown passes, as it has done for more than 1,000 years.
Fucking charisma vacuum, dude. It's insane. Holy shit. I can feel it being drained from me, too.
To our new monarch, our new head of state, His Majesty, King Charles III.
Love that. Love that from a modern democracy. That.
To our new monarch, our new head of state, His Majesty, King Charles III.
Thanks.
With the King's family, we mourn the loss of his mother. And as we mourn, we must come together as a people to support him, to help him bear the awesome responsibility that he now carries for us all.
See, they have no power whatsoever. It means nothing that the current prime minister is saying that the people of this country must come together to support their monarch. thus reaffirming the idea that he is some kind of like a divine conceptual representative of the country. You know, liberals will pretend that everyone treats the monarchy like it's just some cute antiquity with no real power.
So we offer him our loyalty and devotion.
Cool.
Just as his mother devoted so much to so many for so long.
Hey, did you know that if you're a foreigner and you want to be a citizen in like Canada or whatever, you have to swear loyalty to the Queen? If you want to become a citizen of the Commonwealth, not if you're born there, but if you want to become a citizen, like as an immigrant of a Commonwealth country, or at least some of them, you have to swear loyalty to the Queen. Or the King now, I guess. Yeah. Not us here in the US of A, of course. I think they made that optional now. Okay, all right. You can dress up and disguise and neuter your monarchy as much as you want. It's still a fucking monarchy, you know. Oh yeah, yeah. You know, it's not weird at all. We've taken all the dressings of our 1,000-year-old dynasty and we've sprinkled nice dust on it.
And with the passing of the second Elizabethan age, we usher in a new era in the magnificent history of our great country, exactly as Her Majesty would have wished, by saying the words, God save the King.
Fucking charisma vacuum.